The role of the council really is the Public Health Advisory Council for the Monadnock region. And as such, we are targeted with understanding our region from a public health perspective, knowing what the needs and the gaps are, and ultimately being that body who is going to make recommendations on programs and on potential funding to the future. And so today's presentation really is a key component of the work to the future that the council, the role of the council will have. So Polly and Mary are here today to really begin some of that education work with us to help us to really understand issues relevant in the Monadnock region to misuse of alcohol and other drugs. And again, getting back to the core mission of our council, which is looking at needs and gaps, understanding what is going on in our community and what potential funding and resources there are that will align to meet some of those needs. This is one of the steps in that process to begin to make sure that we understand what misuse and alcohol means, how it's impacted in our region, and what potentially we may currently be doing about it, and what we might be doing about it to the future. To sort of tag team before I introduce Polly to get it started, there really is a great opportunity with sort of the confluence of a number of things. You know, Tara talked about the Community Health Improvement Plan. And the base of that plan really is going to afford us the opportunity, hopefully, to get out of our silos a little bit, to learn at a broader scale what is going on in our region so that we can use the limited resources that we have most effectively. So with that, I will turn it over to Polly. Thank you so much for being here today, and the floor is now yours.
Well, before we get started, we have some technical difficulties with our presentation. We only have it on one side, and we can put it on this side, but what we'd have to do would be to shut everything down for a few minutes, maybe do the updates from the end of the meeting first, if people are willing. If not, we'll just have to go with the one screen. Is that
the question over here? Can you people see that screen okay?
And I will send this PowerPoint out electronically to you with the minutes if you'd like, and then, so if people are game with that, then we'll just continue.
Okay.
We're gonna go with it then, thank you.
Thank you,
Eileen, and thank you everyone for coming this morning. I am very pleased to see the turnout today. So the information that we're presenting this morning was from a survey that we sent to you, the FAC members, the council members, asking you what you knew about substance disorder, what you wanted to know, and what was the best way to get this information to you, because we only had this one meeting to present. So you said you liked face-to-face meetings, and you said you liked printed material. So here we are today with face-to-face. And the binders that we have in front of you were put together by a work group, which is some of these folks over here, if you could raise your hand from the work group. These are the folks that worked very diligently over the last 2 months to collect all this information, to put it into this PowerPoint, and to put it into this resource binder. And then we also have planned 4 learning sessions that will be more in-depth of the material we're going to go over today. Today is a brief overview. And I'll give you what we're going to be looking at. This is the overview for today. So there'll be 4 other learning sessions. One's on April 8th, one is on May 6th, one is on June 10th, and one is on September 9th. And again, I'll send that all out to you with the minutes from this meeting, the schedule, and who the speakers are. And they will all be here. They're lunch and learn, so you can come have a quick lunch. We'll have some refreshments and dessert, and then a quick learning session, and off you go. So today we're going to talk about the local conditions, social and financial impacts, the continuum of care, prevention, treatment, and recovery, some of the challenges in New Hampshire, and the integration of care, and the ROSC, which stands for a Resiliency and Recovery-Oriented System of Care. Again, so this is a brief overview, and there are lots of more information about these topics in your binder, and I'll try to point them out as we go along. Here is a visual of some of the behaviors that we're seeing surrounding alcohol and drug use in our region. Some of those slides, those pictures might look pretty familiar to people. The next 3 slides are some data slides, and they're to back up and support the alcohol, tobacco, and other drug problem in the region. So this slide is the Youth Risk Behavior Survey. It's a national data collection that we use in our high schools to collect data around alcohol, tobacco, other drugs, and risky behaviors. You'll note in this slide that the Monadnock region is second in overall use. I know it's a little bit challenging to see this. We are fourth in use of tobacco, second in use of alcohol, and number one for binge drinking. Marijuana use and non-prescribed prescription drugs were tied for third in the state.
That's a telling slide.
It is. And there's more information about the Youth Risk Behavior Survey in your binder, and there's also a glossary in the back for the acronyms. I'm going to try not to use acronyms, but it becomes a habit. So if you have any questions along the way, feel free. Eileen, we also have a parking lot that Eileen's going to be riding on for questions that we may not get to the answers today, or I may not know the answer right this minute, but we can certainly get it to you, or it'll be in the learning sessions later on for more in depth.
One quick question. Excuse me. Because Monadnock region includes Keene State College, and one of the other regions probably includes Plymouth State College, which one of those other regions do you know is Plymouth State?
Plymouth State is in Central.
Central.
But the Youth Risk Behavior Survey
right.
doesn't.
This is high school data. State. This is the high school population.
Right. Yep.
High school.
Okay.
It might influence access to alcohol, access to some of these other substances, which is an important note to make from your question.
And culture, I think.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. Norms, community norms.
I'm just looking at this really quickly. In your perhaps more fine-tooth assessment, are there sort of emergent things like economics or rural versus more urban that pop out, or are these just sort of data that just present in a variety of different ways at different parts of the state?
Yes, it's a variety of different ways in different parts of the state, but then different things pop out because the Youth Risk Behavior Survey covers the risky behaviors, and so they're broken down by schools. So the region-wide data is kind of all of our schools in the region blended together. So obviously, Conval is going to have different data results than, say, Keene High School. So yes.
So Ellen pointed out, like, what's up with dairy?
My first thought was that they lie. But that was not good.
I mean, it's so out of, I mean, everybody else, I mean, there's, you know, windows, but they are so different.
And I don't think that dairy's actually, they're not doing the YRBS right now either, so.
Right, what you may see on these slides, if I could interject this, is that, some of the high schools do what's called the TAP survey, which is the Teen Assessment Project Survey out of UNH. Their data will not be in this YRBS, and Plymouth High School is one of those that does the TAP data. And not all high schools participate in this survey. So you may have some high schools in Derry that don't take it for their own personal reasons, or they may take another kind of survey that's not in this. And we know that not all of the high schools participate. So the data, you know, will look different.
Good to know. Thank you, Sarah.
I have a question. Does it include private high schools like Pinkerton is in Derry? Does that explain?
All high schools are invited to take them, but it's not mandatory. Right.
So, Polly, do you know the high schools in our region?
All the high schools in the Monadnock region are taking the YRBS, and we are now trying to recruit all the middle schools to do the teen assessment project that Sarah was talking about so that we can have more data on our youth. This next slide is the college population, so 18 to 25-year-olds, past 30-day use for prescription drugs without a doctor's orders. This is a 2009 slide, so the data is probably a little bit different than it looks here, but at the time we were fourth for prescription drug misuse in the state. Prescription drug misuse is a concern locally. Adderall seems to be the trendy college drug for staying up late. And it's also trendy in 18 to 25-year-olds for diet purposes, losing weight. And then opiates, of course, are trending everywhere. So prescription drug misuse is a concern locally, statewide, and nationally, and it oftentimes leads to the use of heroin and other opiates. This is the 2012 adult alcohol use from the BRFIS. BRFIS is the Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance Survey. It's from the Center for Disease Control and Prevention. And just to note, it's the world's largest ongoing health survey for credibility for it. In this slide, you'll see that Cheshire County is higher than the state and nationwide for regular use, heavy use, and binge drinking. And then I would also add that sometimes it's challenging to get data that's region-wide data, especially for different populations. We can get it broken down into counties, but the Monadnock region does have some communities that are in the Hillsborough County. So that's one of the challenges, is getting data for the groups that we're looking for. You know, you look at this, and alcohol is one of the things that we as a society really condone. We talk about, we have rituals around alcohol. We have holiday celebrations, weddings, family gatherings, sports events that advertise to our youth. You know, alcohol is a coping skill for people. So it's a wonder there's an increase in underage and binge drinking. As you saw on the YRBS slide, I could go back to that, binge drinking were number one, and that's among our high school youth. So, you know, we really need to think about, as a society, how we look at alcohol. And, you know, New Hampshire, we have alcohol as one of our tax revenues. So that's something that you wanted more information about as well. But just to note that, you know, drinking is really part of our culture. We need to learn how to focus on the culture change. This slide shows the increase in overdose fatalities in New Hampshire. I don't have any local data on this. And the tally from 2014, so we don't have the heroin tally from 2014. Heroin deaths are included in the 253 total, but they have not finished calculating the tallies from 2014. They still have bodies that they don't know if it's overdose fatalities from what. So this is just kind of a visual that the drug overdose fatalities continue to rise. This is from Dr. Thomas Andrew from our New Hampshire Medical Examiner's Office. Drug addiction has become a public health crisis, but I don't feel the social will to attack it exists. Drug-related deaths have increased 400% since 1997. That's less than 20 years. Over the last 3 years, it's been noted that overdose fatalities outweigh car crashes now. There are more deaths due to drug overdose fatalities than there are car crashes. So you've seen some of the data to back up alcohol, tobacco, and other drug use. So the social impacts of this are very broad, and they're challenging to measure. So I thought this was a nice way to have a visual of some of the things that we see in our day-to-day that we might not even realize that we're seeing. We hear them on the news, we see them in the paper. In 2013, our Governor Maggie Hassan declared New Hampshire in a state of emergency. We were a statewide epidemic around opiates and opioids. That's one of the headlines there. And it's not just a local problem, it's nationwide. We've got the Time Magazine article. So drug use and impairment can result in poor anger management, criminal behaviors, violent behaviors, suicide deaths. These are just some of the behaviors associated with alcohol and drug use.
Are those statewide, national, regional?
This is statewide. This is from the New Futures Report, the corrosive effects of misuse of alcohol and drugs. There's a link to it in your binder for more information on that. And then you think about this, and then there's the ripple effect. So you have this data, but for every burglary, toss that pebble in, and the people that were affected, and their neighbors, and their, you know, like all the effects that happen. So these are just some of the behaviors. So we know that there's a connection between alcohol, drugs, and crime. This is a representation from the population with substance use disorder here at the House of Corrections. 352 case management cases from the population here from 2014. So it's just a representation. This is not the entire facility. So this is from the corrosive effects of alcohol and drug misuse on New Hampshire's workforce and economy. You'll note that productivity costs, so loss of productivity costs for the year 2012 was $1.15 billion.
What does AOD stand for?
Alcohol and other drugs. Thanks. So productivity is broken down into impairment and absenteeism. $1.15 billion was lost in productivity. So the obvious thing, if we reduce the misuse of alcohol drugs in our state, that increases productivity, that's better for our economy. And this is also broken down in your binder so you can have more information on it.
Those are just gross numbers, right?
Right.
They're not looking at if you reduce it by this much, you can reduce alcohol and drug use by a certain amount. Is it a straight line, or has any kind of test analysis been done to see how much investment in reduction of drug and alcohol use will improve the economy? Or are those just raw numbers?
Those are raw numbers. In the new futures report, there are the breakdown, and there's different graphs and data that you can look at, and there's a link to that in your binder, so we can get more detail about that. And we'll be going more into detail in that in some of the learning sessions. Good question, though. Thanks. Allison?
And I could jump in with the drug court, so we're a relatively new program, a year and a half old. But at the end of the 3-year grant, we'll have a cost-benefit analysis, so we can basically give you some kind of numbers that will say, like, these components of the program, this, you know, they're contributing members to society, and some of them will obviously be sedated and be put back in jail. We can present some sort of numbers in about a year and a half.
That's wonderful, and that will be local data. This is state. This is based on the statewide data, so that we'll look forward to that, and we'll get that out to people.
There is a definite cost benefit of prevention that is calculated. I don't know if there's a link for that in there, but for every $1 for prevention, the healthcare costs that are decreased due to treatment and recovery costs. So we can make that connection directly between prevention and the cost savings. And those numbers are they're available as well, because there's a direct correlation there. And that's been researched by SAMHSA for a number of years.
And the report goes into more detail about it. So far we've seen the local conditions, a brief overview again, a little bit of the social and financial impacts, and now Mary's gonna come and talk more about the continuum of care and the components of the continuum of care. Here's your remote control. Move forward, move backward.
Great.
There's a little red pointer too.
Yeah, Beth's point was really good. There is a cost-benefit analysis from SAMHSA. For every $1 invested in prevention is $7 in saved costs down the line, which include healthcare. And some of the things that Polly had gone over previously around productivity and absenteeism costs. I want to apologize because I had a slip this morning, and trying to just stay up is a challenge. So bear with me on this one. So the continuum of care is a model that comes down to us from the Institute of Medicine, which I'm sure many of you have seen and are aware of. Recently, I'm thinking it was 2011 in the Mental Emotional Behavioral book update that the IOM put out, the Institute of Medicine put out, which added promotion of health along the bottom of this continuum of care and also as the first part of it, which I think is brilliant because we're trying to reduce our focus on deficits and problems in our region, across the state, in our country, and kind of promote health around the entire spectrum of care. This is also known as the behavioral health spectrum of care. And it has different components in it. the prevention component has three different populations that we target just in the prevention world. Universal is everybody. It's more of the whole population that we use environmental strategies to try to impact, which are, I know this is a lot of language I'm throwing at you, but environmental is more like policy change. These are changes that impact entire populations. Selective and indicated are more for people that have higher risks of using, and indicated are people that are using currently. So we have different strategies for the different populations within the prevention world that we try to, in a comprehensive action plan that we put together, we try to include strategies that will impact all of those populations. Then the second is treatment. We have case ID. We have treatments for the known disorders. And then we have, it kind of mixes in with maintenance and recovery, long-term recovery, maintenance. We're trying to mix them all together so everybody works together. And even trying to move recovery all the way around to hit prevention. So have people in recovery work with people in prevention. So it's more of a unified effort, which is the reason that you folks are here today. The environmental strategies I spoke of, my coalition's funded by the Office of National Drug Control Policy. The money comes directly from Congress and unfortunately bypasses the state. And they give us our two goals, which are to reduce youth, drug use among youth, and to increase partnerships within communities that we cover. And they also give us our strategies. So these are the strategies that we choose. We don't have to do all of them. They encourage us to do as many as we can. In the later sessions, the four information sessions that will be happening after this informational summary session, we'll go into a lot more detail about what these might look like. If, well, not what they might look like, what they do look like, these particular strategies. Like, for example, providing information is real broad. It's putting out information. It's educating the public and the community and presenting at schools and colleges. So I'll go over more of these at one of the prevention information session, which is
May 6th.
Yeah, but when is it again?
It's at 11:30 on Wednesday, May 6th.
Oh, I'm sorry. I said basics. Sorry about that. I'm like, okay. Okay. Some of the successes that we've had in this region are listed here. Smoke-free restaurants, we've had those for a long time. A lot of hard work and a long time that went into getting that to happen. Healthy Monadnock 2020, we are breaking the rules, which this region's kind of known for. Thinking outside of the box and trying to get things done that are not haven't been seen in other places yet. Prescription drug take-back events. Our coalition, among many others across the state in Vermont, it's a national thing, partnered with the Drug Enforcement Administration in taking back excess, unused, and expired prescription drugs people had in their medicine cabinets. Over the 4.5 years that we've done this, New Hampshire has removed almost 22 tons of excess expired and unused prescription drugs. And we presented that, our coalition presented that down in DC to the other drug-free communities as an inspirational thing that you too can help this problem. The only problem with that, I just wanted to point out, for every action there's a reaction, and a lot of, there was a dramatic rise in heroin use as a result of removing this much product off the street. So I told the new DFC grantees, I said, remember on the other end of it, make sure that you put something in place, whether that be increased treatment capacity and infrastructure for current addicts that are using prescription drugs or that may have gone to heroin, and try to make sure that when we do that, we're not just looking at what our successes are today, but what the repercussions are in the long run. As part of our strategy, yeah.
You show the box at the police station.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the only one in the county at this point?
There is
or the region, I should say.
There in Hillsborough, Hinsdale, There is a permanent drop box, but it's only open during business hours. This drop box at the Keene, that's the Keene one, is 24/7, open 24/7. And you can drop your meds off there, just, you know, white, black out any identifying information, no sharps.
Do you mind if I jump in there? Ellen, those are the only two in the region. However, there's been conversations happening with the Antrim Police Department, and, you know, we've spoken with the Jaffrey Police Department, so the DEA was doing these take-back events twice a year, and so that nobody felt the need, and it's expensive because you have to have surveillance cameras and you have to have the disposal piece, which is a lot of money. So there are conversations that are slowly starting to happen, as well as the DEA has lessened the regulations around taking back drugs and prescription drugs. So the pharmacies might be able to now be able to take unwanted and expired drugs as well. So there are things happening in that direction, but we definitely could use more permanent take back boxes in the region, for sure.
A lot of the PDs have limited space. They have absolutely no money. In another capacity, I'm the welfare director for a few towns, and I've offered to put a line item in my prevention budget to cover the costs of getting this stuff, you know, the manpower, the OT that it would cost, plus the transportation cost for the truck to get the supplies to the incinerator. But a lot of them just don't have the space within the station itself, or the extra man time to provide. So we are trying, but that's real slow. The synthetic drugs ordinance, I'm sure many of you heard, I hope many of you heard about, was driven by a parent who had a friend whose kid was getting involved or was involved deeply with spice. And she did something about it, and she rallied support, and we got out there, and we did several community forums around it. Many people were involved in getting this ordinance crafted and developed in the Keene City Council level. Lawyers, the New Futures, there's a lot of people involved in getting the language right. It was brought to the state and was offered as a template to be used statewide for other regions to bring to their city or town government. And I also presented it to the Police Chiefs Association as a template for them to bring back to theirs, town governments to use, to offer. It's just a testament to what we can do and we can get done and are getting done, especially in this region. But we couldn't do it if we didn't have the collaboration that happens. And it just doesn't happen like this in any other region. It's been my experience when I go out and see what's happening. Parents who host lose the most. That's one of the campaigns that a lot of us take part in. We do little pieces of it. Several campaigns throughout the year that try to impact use and make especially parents, a very difficult population to reach, aware of their influence on their children and on how their behavior influences their children's behavior. Moving on to treatment and recovery. Treatment, again, we have prevention, we have treatment, and we have recovery, and they've really operated fairly independently of each other for many years. Treatment and recovery is huge. I can't express how the momentum that particular industry is going to be having. We are 23.5 million people strong in recovery. There's a statewide New Hampshire Hope for Recovery nonprofit that the state and the Hampshire Charitable Foundation is helping to fund, who is planning on opening two recovery centers within the next 2 years in Portsmouth and Manchester, but the executive director wants one in every community in New Hampshire. That's the missing piece in our spectrum in this area. There's very little recovery supports for people. We have very high relapse and, who said that? That's what I was looking for.
There's also more information about Hope for New Hampshire Recovery in your binder, too. And we're hopefully going to have Cheryl Pacapelli, who's the executive director for Hope for New Hampshire Recovery, come down and offer a language training, but that is not yet scheduled. But you'll hear more about that.
So substance use disorders is now is a disorder. It's a medical disorder. It's covered. We have insurance that cover it now. However, it's still considered the dirty little secret that no one will talk about. Tremendous stigma still surrounds addiction. If you read obituaries, you know, I know people who have OD'd with the needle still stuck in their arm. The obituary will not mention drugs. They won't mention it as a cause of death. It was died in their home peacefully. So even in that aspect of things, we're still not talking about the reality that's happening in front of us. It can affect anyone at any time. I think we know that. Any socioeconomic barriers doesn't exist. Not a moral issue. A lot of people still think it's a moral issue. Why can't you just put it down? Why can't you just stop? Once you become dependent or it manifests itself physiologically, there is no choice left. It's not a choice to use. It's what you do. And then without behavioral help or professional intervention, there isn't going to be, I can just stop. There isn't going to be a stop. And there's also high rates of comorbidity, as you saw on the House of Corrections slide, where mental health and substance abuse issues typically occur simultaneously. This slide is mostly for alcohol, but it's to show the different stages of alcohol use and what some of the definitions would be considered at risk, harmful use, dependence, and then chronic dependence. And at that stage, you would be needing the professional intervention.
Mary, can I just add?
You may.
It says diagnose alcohol use disorder, but this can be used for substance use disorder as well from the DSM-5, which is the diagnostic statistics manual that is used to diagnose, that gets the criteria. So this is used for all substance use disorders.
Mary, what's the daily limit?
Yeah. Now, Ellen would know.
Whoa.
You asked for it.
Oh, I love you, Mary. Come on, who else wasn't thinking?
Good question. Good question.
Be honest. So what is the daily limit?
The daily limit depends on women and men. Of course, it's different, but I'm going to put it in the parking lot so I can get you that.
Okay.
Oh, awesome. Yeah. Thanks.
I want to say 1 to 3, but that could be wrong, so we'll get that back to you.
We do know that.
An hour?
Well, if you have, you know, 5 or more in 2 hours, it's considered binge. So we know it's got to be less than that.
Lord.
Yes, I'm sorry.
And I probably should have asked earlier on when Polly was talking about, are there any specific data or statistics? I work specifically with the senior population and with seniors and abuse of alcohol. Is there anything specifically pulled out in the database as far as seniors?
You know, not that I know of. It's well known that they do have Bill might be able to help answer this too, but the Center for Excellence, New Hampshire Center for Excellence, collects data across most populations. I'm not sure if you can add on the senior data.
The National Institute on Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism certainly has data in that regard, as does SAMHSA, the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Administration. And it's clear that as people get older, they can less tolerate alcohol and are more likely to become addicted.
Now, are you talking about data for this region, or
I was
just in general?
General in this region, there was any data.
There is in general. I just don't know about this region.
I don't think there's anybody collecting it. We're doing our strategic plan for the next 3 years, and so we're finding more and more that there's certain populations that there is no data being collected around substance use disorder. So we're working on that and trying to figure out how we can do something about that to start collecting that data.
I think the BRFSS, the BRFSS, has been broken down by age, though. So you could go to that data and break it down by age.
Right, but they would either break it down by county. They wouldn't necessarily break it down by regional. Mm-hmm. So for me, our strategic plan is a region-wide plan. So again, that challenge of who in our local community is collecting that data is what we're trying to figure out.
I will say that when we did, I included as a partner the Sheriff's Department when we did our last 3 prescription drug takebacks, and we included 7 of Southwestern Community Services senior properties to go get their meds so they wouldn't have to, or if they couldn't leave the house, to go to the police department and drop it off. So his deputies lined up a schedule where they would go to each of the senior properties and collect their meds, and they were sitting there waiting for him, and it was a really great partnership. I think the first time he collected about 53 pounds off those 7 properties alone. Yeah.
Another great question, though.
Yeah, yep. Again, recovery in New Hampshire, this is going to be much bigger. Process change through individuals actually improve their health and wellness and their lives overall. We're going to be tying a lot of treatment already now, and Allison could probably expand on this. Treatment now, especially in the drug court, includes development of networking, recovery networking supports. So people have, those kind of supports to go to during treatment and after the treatment. Did you want to talk to that a little bit?
Well, specifically in drug court, we have 3 phases, but we've developed a 4th phase, which is an aftercare, continuing care phase, and something that we're adding on because it's sort of federally mandated and it's happening nationwide is we're adding an MAT to our program.
Which is?
Medically assisted treatment. So that's, we're actually beginning that next week, which is fraught with many issues and very complicated. But because of that, we're also developing a sort of a sustaining recovery group for those people that are in. So they graduate, they'll still be continually maintained and followed because they'll still be on medication, but medication that's opioid-based, so it's complicated.
Yeah.
But we are networked with everyone in the community. We have our intensive outpatient groups, and people in our program continue in that if they choose, or other aftercare programs. But we also network with local providers, and I mean, it's a continuing process, and would love to network with anyone in the community that wants to be involved.
And we'll have these other learning sessions that will have more in-depth information about training and the medication-assisted treatment and other information. And Allison has offered to put some information in our binder for this in the future, so you'll have more information on the drug court system.
I'm going to interrupt just for a second. I'm getting signals. If everybody that's commenting could speak up just a little bit.
Thank you.
Because everybody on the other side of the room is having trouble hearing us.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So I think it's a great point. It's a great example also of the way that different agencies in the region can collaborate together. Allison's doing it. Her grant and the drug court program is actually a motivator, I think, to try to have other agencies think about how you operate and how we can do better as far as supporting someone comprehensively long term. This is some of the things that are happening right now in our area regarding treatment and recovery. We have Monadnock Family Services, which is the mental health. Is anybody representing them? Oh, Phil's here today. Hey, Phil. Whoop, whoop. Phoenix House in Keene. We have Phoenix House in Dublin. Private practice medical facilities, CMC. The Keene Metro Treatment Clinic. Anybody hear from that today? That's also one of the medical assisted treatment facilities that Allison was speaking to. Monadnock Area Support, Jude is here today. We have AANA, Alateen, and Al-Anon support groups. We've got the Keene Serenity Center, which is a new recovery support nonprofit in Keene, in the same building as the Phoenix House. We have FASTER, which is peer-to-peer support, and then we have HOPE for New Hampshire Recovery, which is the statewide recovery agency that's going to do some big stuff. They're in a big multi-million dollar campaign right now. So, and if you can get 23 million people working together, you're going to be successful, I can guarantee it. And the motivation for people in recovery that work is just so different than our typical, you know, ego-driven salary compensation motivation for working. So I have a great feeling we're going to do a lot of good stuff.
You just used a data point that I'm trying to get clarity. You said if we can get 23 million people working together
in the country.
I think there's in the country. Okay,
yeah.
I was thought of 6.
Yeah, yeah.
I missed some.
Yeah, that's
really grew overnight, Jack.
Nationally. But I'm just really, there's a lot of momentum around that right now, and it's just some really good stuff that's going to be happening.
Yeah.
However, New Hampshire has some serious challenges. Not to be a Debbie Downer, but we need to take a look at them, and that's one of the reasons that you're all here, is that we can kind of take a look at this and see, as we work together to kind of identify our vision for the future, what we need to know what we're dealing with. First off, New Hampshire Health Protection Plan, we finally expanded Medicaid in this state. So we have a federally funded plan that will expand coverage to cover substance use disorders. There's another 7,000 to 9,000 people that are now eligible for substance use disorder treatment. And there's a problem with that. I mean, that's wonderful news, but we typically, before, I'll talk more to that other point in a couple seconds. 6% identified it as needing treatment can actually get it. New Hampshire is the second to last in the country to provide affordable, accessible treatment to its residents, only behind the state of Texas. And say that again?
I said that's not a good club you want to be in.
No, no. And when they do that 50-state slide, and we're like right here, I'm ashamed, you know.
Yeah. Do we know what that statistic was several years ago before the budget cuts that went into place in the last meeting?
No. I could probably get that from Tim Rourke, who is at the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation.
We'll put that in the parking lot.
Yeah.
Can you ask your question again a little bit louder?
Oh, I'm sorry. My question was whether we had that statistic for several years ago prior to the last biennium when there were such budget cuts for the Department of Health and Human Services, right, and some of that went towards drug and alcohol treatment.
And those cuts weren't just on the state level. That was that.
No, they were not.
Yeah, the federal.
Certainly.
So we can maybe get both of those numbers for you. So like I had said, the coverage makes another average 7,000 to 9,000 people that have been identified as needing treatment eligible for getting substance use treatment. But the problem in New Hampshire is we don't have the infrastructure and the capacity to get those people covered. We don't have the workforce. We don't have the treatment facilities like we showed on that other slide. There's Phoenix House in this area, and then you've got some on the coast, but New Hampshire is sorely lacking in infrastructure and capacity and workforce, treatment workforce, to be able to actually help this new 7,000 people that are eligible for help. And as far as I know, the Bureau has some money they're trying to put out into the state. Could you talk to that a little bit, Bill, to build that infrastructure?
Yeah, I can't.
Okay. I'll find out more about it and see what's happening, and get that to you, Eileen. Liquor Commission in New Hampshire is it's always been a bit of an enigma to me, a little bit of a puzzle. They have extraordinary amount of revenue, that 5% of which was supposed to be going toward treatment and recovery, treatment and prevention activities in the state. And for some reason, every year something happens to make that not happen. Gross profits, as you can see, you know, continue to climb. I don't think we had 2014 at the time of this, where we put this slide together. But this is what we're actually getting. And the promise is around 5%, but I think we're actually getting, I think it was around 2%.
3%.
Where's the rest of it go?
In the general fund.
So the bottom line.
Mm-hmm. What's the net profit? For a lot of that comes out of the cost of the alcohol. I'm curious what the difference is.
Net profit. We'll find out. Good question. I did meet. I have been meeting with the liquor commissioner as of late to develop a nice relationship about this, and to see if he would be willing to buy curriculum or partner on different types of strategies that we could use prevention money for, that I know that he set aside, particularly for prevention. And he says there is a budget line. It's very well protected. It's very highly guarded. And so I'm sure that plays with politics, and I'm not sure about all of that. But when I look at a slide like this, it really makes me think of, well, how much money do you need? I mean, if you took out the money that it took to pay for the staff and the alcohol and the rent or whatever on the buildings, if they own them, how much money would you really be able to give us that 5%? And that those questions have to come out real gently.
And the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation, they're really trying hard to work with the Governor's Commission to be sure that we do get the 5%. So I know that's one thing that's on their priority list.
And it would help tremendously this region, statewide actually, if we actually got what was promised in both fields, prevention and treatment. So far we've covered the local conditions, social and financial impacts, the continuum of care, prevention, treatment, and recovery, and the challenges that we face in New Hampshire. Are there any questions so far around what we've covered that haven't been asked?
Go ahead, Jen.
So,
we went to high school together. I'm at U of R, Jen.
So, I'm curious if you've got any information that shows. I mean, you've talked about how this is a socioeconomically equal opportunity issue. At the same time, is there any work looking at the treatment continuum that looks at training people to have meaningful work lives and things like that, which can sort of become self-fulfilling in the best sense, where economic opportunity doesn't exist, it becomes self-fulfilling in the negative sense? I don't know if that's a reason.
Let me try to rephrase it and see if I got that. So you're talking about a treatment plan that would include
meaningful work training, things that can
employment training
add value to people's lives, that gets them focused on what on opportunity and future success, as opposed to I'm not getting anywhere, my life is kind of in this perpetual downward spiral.
Most treatment
something
plans
like
do
that
include that.
Yeah.
Right. Nicely done.
Segue.
Nice segue.
No, but most treatment plans do include those components. But Allison's going to speak a little bit.
So the drug court's a multidisciplinary team of people, and we have treatment. We also have case management, and Connie Flagg is our case management person, and she has over 20 years in substance abuse, and we set goals in our case management plan, and so one thing that we make sure is that if they don't have their GED or high school diploma, we get them towards that, and we work closely with Vogue Rehab, and we also have mentoring, we also have local workforce that help with business plans. One person who graduated, he helped to work on a business plan. So that's one of our models, is not only to get someone substance abuse free, but also to move forward in their life. I mean, we have people that are graduating, and one's now back in college. So to propel them forward in their future, our goal is not only to be sober, but to move forward in the workforce and become a successful member of society, a productive member, attacking. So that's one of the goals of drug court and a lot of other treatment programs.
Yeah.
Margaret has a question over there.
At the River Center, we have an employment resource center, and so it's just come to our attention that there is unique issues involved with recovering population in getting back in the workforce. So that is something that's come to our attention, that we are going to start looking at that. How can we specifically be stepping into taking our expertise in employment with that recovery population? So
that that's what we're going to talk about in this slide. So thank you for your feedback and the question. And I know from my own experience, I worked at the Phoenix House for several years, and they had a long-term residential program that was cut when all the budget cuts came down nationally and statewide. And they did the same thing, similar to what Allison is doing with the drug courts, only you weren't, you didn't have to go to jail first to get there. You could go and apply to get in through state funds, and so they took Vermont beds, and they had state beds, and then they had private pay beds. They have, the Dublin Phoenix House still has a residential treatment center, but it's short term, and the challenges of getting a bed are extreme because there's waiting lists that are so long. There's only one adolescent program in the state, and that is has 12 beds at the Phoenix Academy. And the state doesn't give any funding towards that. So that's one of the challenges, is that they took away long-term residential treatment in the state of New Hampshire. And so now we have the drug courts, and that's great, and the work that they're doing is fantastic. But we already had that once, and it got cut. So that's the whole idea of this ROSC. So this is an integrated system of care. It's a systematic coordination of networks, agencies, and ancillary supports. So everything that a person who may have mental health or substance use issues, everything they touch in their life, everything they have to go through, could be addressed if we have this resiliency and recovery-oriented system of care. We mentioned Hope for New Hampshire Recovery trying to open recovery centers, and that's part of the model for the recovery center, is to provide education, is to help you get your GED, is to help you with, you know, budgeting, and so with life skills in general, as well as to get you to be an advocate for recovery services in your state. So that's this whole model of the ROSC, is all these folks working together to support people with behavioral health issues. Robin.
I have sort of a broad umbrella question, I think it is, and that is, I'm trying to understand the lens that you're using as you approach this project and this work. And from what I mean, we just got the binders here, and I've read Jack's introduction letter, and so far what I've heard is that the lens that you're taking is more of a situational access, a cultural sort of privilege that exists. When I read Jack's letter, that it's sort of a culturally accepted thing to either misuse alcohol or drugs, and then the other thing is access. So I'm wondering if there is a space, or if it's just not evident to me, to kind of coin that public health phrase of swimming upstream and understanding a little bit more what the root causes are. I don't know. This seems like I understand that there's still, you know, need for intervention, recovery, treatment, and that's been lacking for a while. So that's one thing that I just wonder. And the reason that I wonder is because of the work that I do, and because I understand what trauma exposure does to people. And I also understand that sometimes people are self-medicating, but sometimes they also get a lot of help doing that when they present to their medical professional or mental health professional with all these somatic things that don't seem to ever tie together in our model right now of delivery of either medical care or mental health care. So I'm wondering about looking at trauma as a root cause, trauma exposure. I'm also, when I see medical there, there's maybe Eileen is representing the medical community or Tom, but it seems to me that screening for some of these things and the integration of mental health, and we continue to separate mental health and health, mm-hmm. and they're not separate. So I don't see any physicians or pediatricians here, and maybe that's a scheduling thing, mm-hmm. that it's not possible for them to join this group, but. And maybe Eileen's the conduit, or maybe Tom's the conduit, I don't know.
We've got Leanne Clark here from the Monadnock Community Hospital. We've got Eileen and Tom here, and I would say, yes, they're probably the conduits to these places. And what I'm thinking as you're asking what you're asking is that, yes, the root cause is what we need to drill down more, and I think we already have some of the answers. You're talking about the medical model and symptoms that we treat, and then the silos of what's happening already to try to deal with the individual pieces of substance use disorder, behavioral health, medical, physical issues. So this recovery, resiliency and recovery-oriented system of care is one system of care that's going to happen specifically for behavioral health. We have initiatives that are happening in the region. We have the drug court system that Allison is working on, another integrated system of the judicial system and treatment and some prevention. And then we have a controlled substance management network grant that's happening, and that's working with medical professionals and treatment and trying to figure out on evidence-based best prescribing practices. Am I correct on that, Beth? And then we also have the Children's Behavioral Health Systems of Care grant. So there's people at that table all trying to figure out how we can have a better system for children's behavioral health. So these are the things that are happening, and I think within each system, they're drilling down to see what the root cause is for what's happening within that population. And then my thoughts on that, Robin, is this public health network now, with the decision makers here in this room, we'll start looking at those systems and figure out how we can make that larger, broader system. The 30,000 foot view is what some of my people say. So I'm thinking that that's a great question, and this is why we're doing this work, to start heading, you know, in that direction, so that we're all working on one broad system of care that's connected. And I know it's referred to as no wrong door, or, you know, the wraparound. And so I think that's where we're headed through this, and I'm hoping that's the direction we're going. Eileen, do you have anything you want to add to that?
So I think that's a really good point, and I would think that when you think historically, it very siloed. You know, same thing with oral health. There's no connection that the teeth have anything to do with the body. But that's a question for another day. But I think that in terms of recognizing healthcare and behavioral health, so one thing first, I would say that, yeah, I think that my role is that conduit. When we hire back the VP of Population Health, that person also will be part of this, and that is another person that will be a conduit to Cheshire Medical, Dartmouth Hitchcock Keene. Sort of off the, you know, underneath this council, we have a lot of things happening that are really recognizing that behavioral health and healthcare delivery as siloed approaches don't work. It just doesn't work, you know. So we've got a group that Beth leads that is around looking at controlled substance management. Individuals who have addiction issues to opioids through pain management. They hurt themselves, they go see their doctor, they get prescribed these meds, and voila.
Or they're hurting in a way that doesn't show.
Right.
And
so how do we look at, you know, that's downstream. Yeah. The problem is already there. So there's several things happening. Upstream is, in Polly and in Mary's world, is around prevention. How can we support our community so we never have that person get addicted? At the same time, recognizing we need to support those who are, and how can we do that effectively? Phil is very much involved working with the leadership at Dartmouth Hitchcock around how do we look at integrating our care. So we have individuals with severe and persistent mental illness who may or may not be connected to a primary care doc in our system. How can we take our primary care system to his site to best meet the needs of the individuals that for whatever reason can't or aren't comfortable coming to the clinic? How can we take the best of what MFS has to offer and bring that to the clinic to support what we are doing there? So it's a process, you know, that there is definitely, you know, there's, as Polly said, the system of care work, looking at children with behavioral health and emotional concerns. How can we as a community wrap our heads and our arms around an effective way to serve that family unit? And it's not the typical healthcare model, it's the why. The why has a stakeholder group. They have something to offer. You know, Voc Rehab has something to offer. The churches have something to offer. So it's looking outside of our normal way of addressing healthcare, and how do we get different groups together to look at how to most effectively support them?
So going off what you said about the getting physicians here, I think that's definitely an issue that we have, and that's why we're kind of here representing the hospitals, and the physicians obviously right now are seeing patients, and that's why they can't be at these meetings. So just to give you a short little story, so there was an article that I had a quote in there saying that we find that a lot of people, a lot of new mothers that have C-sections get prescribed a lot of Percocets. They get prescribed probably more than they really need, maybe 50 pills. And by day five, they're feeling better. They don't really need them, but now they have a screaming baby at night, and they have this Percocet that's gonna make them feel better and relax them. So I put this in the article, and yesterday I had a doctor, one of the OBGYN docs, come up to me, and he said, I didn't know I'm starting an addiction for some patients. And he's like, can you explain this to me? And so I explained to him a little bit, and I said, if you prescribe 50 Percocets to a patient, and now they have postpartum depression, and the only way that they can get to sleep at night is by taking these Percocets, and now they've taken one every night for 50 days. Now the 50 days are over, and you're not gonna re-prescribe them, so where are they gonna turn to? They're gonna go to the street to get the drugs, and then they're gonna turn to other things such as heroin or Oxycontin or wherever they can get off the streets. So he looked at me and he's like, we really need to educate more doctors about this. And I think that's the thing. I think there isn't a tie between the doctors and what we're doing. And so I was gonna talk to Polly at this meeting, and I'm gonna try to get at one of the full provider meetings, trying to get at least 20 minutes on the agenda, which is so hard to get on these doctors' agenda. They have like 1 hour a month that they can talk about things. And so we're gonna try to get it on the agenda to educate these doctors. And I asked, I said, why do you prescribe 50? Why don't you just prescribe 10 of them, and then if they need more? And he said, because if they're sick in the middle of the night and they just went through this surgery, or they just gave birth, that's huge, that's painful. And I can't just call in the prescription. They're gonna have to come back in, and that costs them more money to get them back into the office, have them have a visit, and then they have to get more prescription, more pills, and that just costs them more money. So I'm trying to save the patient money. But in the end, they're really not saving the patient.
And I would say that there is a correlation, not a cause.
Yes.
A correlation with postpartum and previous trauma exposure.
Yes, yeah. Definitely. So I think that, that's all tie in together. Getting docs to the table is difficult. And that's kind of what, from, I'm sure Cheshire is the same as Monadnock. I mean, it's not easy to get them there. Even at a full provider meeting, it's not easy to get them go to their own meeting.
Sexual assault nurse examiners and medical training that we try to deliver through our work from the state. And unless you have medical professional delivering the training, it's really hard to get table. CEUs help, but it's really hard to get that on.
I think it's about finding that champion somewhere to recruit everybody else. I know Mary and myself, we have tried to get in to speak to docs and bring trainings, and there just isn't time. New Hampshire, however, has just now, we have the prescription monitoring program in play, up and going, and it is mandatory, and it's the law, so all of our prescribers will have to register on the prescription monitoring program, so there'll be a little bit more communication so that people won't be able to get medication quite as easily. And I know that it's much more strict nowadays. There are contracts, and maybe Phil, you could speak to that. There's different ways that people have to sign contracts and do other things before they can get the larger prescribed doses of medicine. So, Kathy.
I have a question about employers, and it occurs to me that, we have a drug-free campus, and we have a zero tolerance for drug use or alcohol use in the workplace. And that's to protect our patients and the people we serve. Makes sense. We, in our zero tolerance policy, if someone shows up impaired and they are, in fact, deemed impaired, we have no recourse except to terminate them. It seems to me that policy might be contributing to the problem, and yet it is a generally accepted human resource policy. Is there an opportunity for an employer to be involved with the management system for this substance abuse treatment to allow for a second chance? Realizing that it resonates that once there's the dependence, there is no choice. And so when there is no choice, do we hold people accountable for their behavior in the same way? So I, this is just reeling in my head about whether or not we are contributors to a problem in some way, because it's a downhill slide.
And I think that's
safety net.
That's definitely a great question, and I think that reviewing policy work is something that we would be glad to help you with. And I know that there are workforce trainings, and I think that because we're seeing marijuana coming into the picture now, that that's something that we really do need to begin to start taking a look at. I know Mary wanted to add something to that.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that when you come to the next informational seminar, the prevention one particular, one of those environmental strategies is around policy change, and one of them happens to be training around HR and what businesses themselves can do. For instance, add money to their budget for prevention, education, training, intervention, for treatment, for recovery supports. So there's a ton of things that employers can do, which we will cover in the prevention seminar. So that you're more than welcome to bring your boss to, unless you're the boss.
Bill.
Yeah, and I would just add, I mean, the other reality is there are a number of businesses that have employee assistance programs, and there should be something on the parking lot in terms of more information sharing among those individuals.
Mm-hmm. Good point.
It would be great to have like a model practice or model policy for an employee assistance program.
There are.
Hold people accountable, keep your population safe if you're a service delivery, but yet give that person the opportunity to do something, to change or seek help.
Yeah, just adding to that quickly, I mean, one of the, in terms of occupations with a tendency to becoming addicted, maybe I shouldn't say it in this group, but physicians who prescribe, obviously, and nurses are probably more likely than most to become addicted, but then also they have some of the better employee assistance program policies in terms of making treatment available, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And that includes here in New Hampshire.
Thanks, Bill. Jude.
I just want to speak a little bit to kind of the conversation that's going around, and I think that the point that you brought up, Leanne, is wonderful, because what a lot of prescription drug use then does turn to addiction. But I also think that we would be remiss if we didn't sort of honor an individual in having their personal choice. Just because you're prescribed something does not mean you will be addicted to it. I think that's important to remember in this context. And I also think that if you're, speaking to Robin's point, if you're looking at recovery and prevention, a lot of it is that the sort of root cause, like you were saying, is trauma. And how do we look at trauma as a community? How do we look at it as a culture? How do we support each other? The whole way of sort of being able to look at a person holistically and not having, your dental health and your mental health and your physical health all be separate. Mm-hmm. If you can look at something in a holistic way, with one of the causes, realizing that one of the causes is trauma. How do we prevent trauma? How do we support people who have been exposed to trauma? That sort of thing. I just think there's a really strong correlation there.
Thanks, Jude. This conversation is rich, and you're actually doing my work for me. I appreciate that. So I'm flipping to the next slide to look back at the continuum, Jude, as you're making that motion with your hands, talking about the holistic approach to treating an individual and their families and their supports. And so the continuum of care is the ROSC. It is an integrated system of care that's long-term and comprehensive. And that's what we're trying to get to. So we have that combination of behavioral health. So it's general health and medical health care all lumped together, and getting the medical professionals on board with that. So again, somebody's getting treated for all through their continuum for anything that they have, and they're talking with everyone that they come into contact with as far as any kind of trauma or issues or voc rehab. So it's that integrated system of care that we're trying to get. And I know we're almost done. So the last couple of slides are just an example of the continuum of care again, and so a few examples of what is happening, and then some of the challenges that I want to leave you with, being that you're going to be the decision makers for our future. So health promotion, we have Healthy Monadnock. We're going to be the healthiest community in the nation. Youth building skills, All-Stars is a curriculum used in some of the schools to help with life skills for children. The Media Collaborative is this unique relationship that we have in our region. It's the Shopper, the Sentinel, and the Monadnock Radio Group, and they work closely with us in prevention to put out messages that are prevention messages and to advertise events that are coming up, community forums, et cetera. And and the Sentinel's been doing some pretty good work around talking about substance use disorder and specific topics around opiates and heroin. Some of the needs, it's the data. We have the YRBS is a solid data collection that we use, but there's other data that we're trying to use, like the teen assessment program. We need more of a youth voice, promoting more of a youth voice. We have Healthy Monadnock has some programs going on, but we don't have that strong youth group leadership. Prevention, we have two drug-free community grants. We have Mary's the director of the Monadnock Alcohol and Drug Abuse Coalition, and we have ACCESS out of Winchester. ACCESS stands for All Children Educated, Safe, and Supported. That's in Winchester, however, so that's, you know, they're zip code specific. Mm-hmm. The Partnership for Success 2 grant, which is Sarah Sutherland's our coordinator for that. She's working with Franklin Pierce University and Keene State College. As well as Monadnock Voices for Prevention to bring strategies to the campuses and use in the community to reduce underage and binge drinking as well as prescription drug misuse, and then sort of indirectly bridging the gap between colleges and the communities. Some of the needs are parents. It's really tough to get people to come. It's just like doctors, parents don't have time. They're taking their kids to sporting events. We've tried actually thinking of having a group at a sporting event. Okay, so you drop your kid over here and you come over here to our class. But parents don't have the time. So even incorporating social media in and doing online practices, it's just really tough to get the parent audience. Funding is still a challenge in all the continuum of care components. So if we had more of that prevention funding from the alcohol fund, we might be able to do more with the environmental strategies that we use. Community input, and then young people not knowing where to go for help. That's kind of confusing, because if you ask a young person, they're going to tell you they know where to go to do everything. But if you ask a young person where they're going to go to get help from somebody, they're hesitant to go to authority, they're hesitant to go to a counselor, they're hesitant to go to an SAP in their school. So trying to find a youth voice for more peer-to-peer support among our youth. Treatment. We have several treatment facilities. We have private practice, LADACs. But we need to build that capacity. We need to have more people for the workforce in treatment, and we need to have the infrastructure built. And I know that it was mentioned that the Bureau of Drug and Alcohol Services is working hard statewide to try to figure out how we can build that infrastructure. And one of the things they're doing is this right here. Each region has their FAC that's getting educated the same way on how this resiliency and recovery-oriented system of care can work in their community. And we're ahead of the game, just so you know. And then recovery. So we have Monadnock Area Peer Support Agency. Jude, do you want to say just a little bit about the Monadnock Area Peer Support Agency?
One of the things that we're looking at that we've had in the past is a dual diagnosis support group. So we provide support groups for adults 18 and over who self-identify as having a mental health issue or a co-occurring disorder. We're free. Everyone on staff goes through a training. We really try to look at the whole person about education. We try to be anti-stigma, empowerment. I work there, so I can say it's a really lovely place, but I'm also a really strong believer in it. So if you have any questions, our information is in the binder, so please feel free to get in touch with us.
Thanks, Jude. So then we have needs and challenges, and transportation comes up every time. Housing, these are the same things that come up at every group that I go to. So obviously it's a huge problem. And this is a summary. So today we've seen the local conditions. You've seen some of the social and financial impacts. You've seen challenges for New Hampshire. You've seen what we have here, what we're doing, what we need more of. I want to just reiterate that we're going to have more in-depth in these four learning sessions. The dates are up there in the times. And I'm sorry I forgot my flyer, but I'll send that out to you electronically. They'll be here. They'll be 11:30 to 1 o'clock. Each session will be 15 minutes to eat. So you bring your lunch and we'll have some drinks and some dessert. We'll have the learning sessions with the speakers that are up there speaking to the topics. And then there'll be a question and answer for the last 15 minutes. There will be an RSVP on that because of space limitations. But I encourage you all to please come to those. And the great gift is that we're recording this. So not only will these sessions be on Cheshire TV, but there will be a link to a YouTube, or there'll be a YouTube link so we can send it out to other people or people who may have missed today. And then we can use this for our future.
Will the learning sessions be taped?
Yes, they will. Yes, they will.
You can all put them on your websites.
Yes, that's
everybody.
Definitely. So just one last look at that integrated system of care, long-term and comprehensive. And then just some happy faces for the end. I thank you all for your rich conversation. Are there any other questions that we have right now? I know we're close to our end of time.
Not really a question, just a commentary. I think it's wonderful to see people in this room who've collected the numbers, who are running the programs, or people who are in the trenches, and people who are peripheral people that are learning about that. That's wonderful. The elephant in the room, or the elephant not in the room, I guess, are the people from our legislature, you know, and some of our medical providers, that I think there's a lot of really rich information that needs to be shared with people who control the purse strings for the state and funding programs that seem to be so desperately needed, and for medical providers who certainly have a lot of skin in the game as well. So the fact that this is going to be on Cheshire TV, the fact that there are learning sessions available, it would be great for those of us who come in contact with political folks and for medical providers to really encourage them to get more involved in it as well. There's a great representation today, and I think we have the opportunity to have those discussions.
Thank you. I couldn't have said it better.
To follow on to Tom's, I think, really important remarks, I think our tendency, having done a lot of work advocating in the legislature, our tendency is we're in the middle of the battle, let's get the legislature to do this. The legislature is right now in the middle of deciding budgets. We should be educating them on these things in what is their downtime, which is not going to occur between now and June. We should be thinking about summertime, early fall, when they're not in session, when they're thinking about new legislation that they might introduce and how we might get them to embrace some of the issues that have been discussed here. It's not going to happen. We've got to do it now. They need to kind of figure this out and have not feel under pressure to make a decision on a vote today or tomorrow. I don't know if that's your experience.
I think Jack is absolutely right in terms of availability of legislators and their ability to think about it. As speaking as 10 years in the New Hampshire House, but I also wanted to take the other side of the argument and say right now they are making the decisions. The one legislator from this area in the House that's on the House Finance Committee that really makes those decisions is Dan Eaton from Stoddard. So if any of you know Dan, now is the time to, in fact, reinforce the need for funding in this area. And the other is, obviously, to reinforce it to Senator Molly Kelly. Molly, I think, does care about these issues, but it wouldn't hurt to give her a call, too.
Exactly, and Molly Kelly was at a meeting I was at the other night, and we invite the legislators, we invite the medical professionals. It's just trying to figure out how we can get in a time frame where they have more access to in their day. So I agree with everything that was said as far as that goes. We do try to advocate all year round, but then there's the push time too, so I definitely agree. I guess Phil, Jude, Sarah.
I just wanted to just thank people who prepared for this meeting. And I think you presented a lot of material, great presentation, rich sort of a lot of material for us to think about. And the office, people obviously did a lot of work to prepare for this. It's just very
the work group, they did a great job. Thank you.
I'm just going to give it to Sarah. I just saw these two hands waving.
Oh. We have about 5 minutes left. Just
okay,
so
I have two things for the parking lot. You asked what the Liquor Commission's net profit was for last year. It was $139,732.
Say that again.
$139,732.
Thank you.
Was the net profit. And also the CDC, their daily limit
for
dietary guidelines, as they put it, for Americans is one drink for a woman and two drinks for a man.
Oh.
In a time frame or per
day?
Daily. And is that a really big drink or do they give a size?
It's a
super gulp or whatever.
Take your vitamin, take your vitamin. Any other questions or comments? So this resource binder that you were handed out, there's room in there. So when you go to these learning sessions, they're going to be giving you more information on what they're covering that day. And I'm going to stress again that they're lunch and learn, so they're not going to be a huge, you know, time constraint on you. It's going to be about a 45-minute session with 15 minutes at the end to have question and answer and 15 minutes in the beginning for networking and lunch. So I encourage you to come to those. We originally wanted to open them up to the public, but the best location is here for you as council members, and you're my targeted audience, and then that's the reason that we're recording it and having the link so we can open them up to the public perhaps and tag it on with a community forum where we have some recovery speakers, which we're having those all around the states. And I'll make another plug for if you haven't seen the movie The Hungry Heart or the movie The Anonymous People. The Hungry Heart deals with a doctor who was prescribing Suboxone, which is a medication prescribed for people with opiate dependency, and how he dealt with it in his community. It's over in St. Albans. And then The Anonymous People talks about the 23.5 million people in recovery, this movement that's sweeping the nation that's been happening for several years that's now really coming to voice. And so it's talking about the stigma on mental health and substance use, and they're both very powerful movies. I would recommend them. I have them in my resource library, so please reach out. I'll be glad to loan them out.
The opiate effect.
Oh. Yes, there's a 23-minute YouTube video called The Opiate Effect that Keene High School recently showed to the students there, and then they had a discussion panel with law enforcement and someone in recovery. They had an EMT, and they had a father. Oh, they had somebody from the Phoenix House in Dublin, the Academy, and they had a father who had lost a son to an overdose fatality a year previous. It was very powerful. Students were not on their phones. They were not talking. They were listening. So that is also a link you can find on YouTube. Again, MVP has a resource library, so if anybody's interested in these materials, I oftentimes have them. I don't think I'm forgetting anything. Any other questions, comments, Sarah?
I just want to thank you guys for having the passion to be here and to be on this council and to take the steps forward that you're taking to make this work happen. So thank you to you for being here and letting us have the opportunity to educate and give you the information. But, you know, without you, where would we be? So thank you for being here and doing what you're doing.
Eileen, over to you, or Mary Lee.
And thank you, Holly, Mary, all our guests for coming and speaking of such an important topic. I learned a lot, and I know I'm looking forward to the learning sessions, and I think we can do a lot as a council to help promote this. I'd like to take a couple of minutes to have any kind of updates. Anybody want to share anything? Excuse me. Any partner updates at all?
It was briefly talked about, but FASTER is a new peer-to-peer support group, and it is for loved ones who are suffering from addiction. And it is at Monadnock Community Hospital every Thursday from 7 to 8:30. And we finally had two people come last night, so that was great.
It's been
going on for 1 month now. It's run by two mothers who have sons who are in recovery right now, so but definitely spread the word. There's flyers, there's not flyers. We'll send out flyers.
I would piggyback on that, Leanne. There's also going to be a group, a FASTER group in Keene, and these are trained facilitators. They're not just people who decided to have this group. They're trained by NAMI, which is the National Alliance for Mental Illness, and they have these groups formed all over different parts of the state. And so we have now one in Peterborough, and we will be having one in Keene. We're looking for a co-facilitator. So MVP has more information on that, and I have the flyers and things, so I can always send them out again.
Thank you. Any other updates? Maybe Eileen, can you pick? Oh, I'm sorry. Phil?
Just want to say, we had our first mental health first aid class a couple weeks ago, and it worked out pretty well. The speaker wasn't too bad, so it was
good. He was just
Good.
Well, I will say that I have heard through the grapevine that it was an incredible class. Very well received. And the speaker was awesome.
Very good.
To follow up on that, Phil is coming to the Eastern Monadnock region on April Fool's Day to present our not the full workshop for full 8 hours, but is presenting an overview of medical first aid to our volunteer drivers. And we've opened it up to anybody that might want be interested in coming for us. A brief overview. We'll be at Monadnock Community Hospital, and it's from 5 to 7. So if anybody wants, I can send out information through Eileen. But we thank Phil. I just think our drivers, I think everybody could use it. And I think the point that was made on the website as I was writing up the description is that what is it? People don't, if somebody falls or if somebody has a heart attack, people rush to them. But if somebody's having a panic attack, people tend to run the other way. And so I just think, we can all be better prepared. I think it's something useful for everybody. So I'll get that information out to you all. And thank you, Phil, for coming over to
April.
So one of the things we've been trying to do is have community forums around substances that are trending in the area. Keene High School had one on opiates and heroin use, and then we had one in Jaffrey on synthetics and heroin use. We're having one in Peterborough on the 24th at Peterborough High School, at Conville High School, and it's going to be two young men in recovery telling their story, but before that there'll be a little bit of overview of the local conditions, and then Terry Choate from the Jaffrey Police Department will talk about the signs and symptoms. There'll be lots of resource tables there. So here's one flyer, and I have this again electronically, and there's flyers pretty much posted all over about this. We're trying to get one in the Monadnock Regional School District for coming up soon. So look for more of these community forums and trainings and the anonymous people showings, and we're trying to get them to happen all over all the time.
Any other updates? Eileen, you want to, Jeff?
Yeah, so I mentioned at the beginning I'm in the process of developing a center for civic engagement at Antioch. And as part of this project, one of the things we're trying to figure out is what we're going to take on in the community. And one of those possible broad community conversations, which this is certainly a very important beginning of, involving people who kind of live this stuff at one level or another on a very daily basis. But at the end of the day, part of our challenge is to have these conversations at a dispersed way across the community among people who perhaps don't know anything about it or have their silver bullet strategy. If you just did this, it would all be. And the way, one of the things we're looking at is the possibility of having this the conversation about drug and alcohol issues in our community as one of the forums that we would facilitate. I'm not prepared to say we would do that because we've got to go through a process, but it is a big issue nationally. One of the organizations we work with, which is the National Issues Forum Institute, which is based in Ohio, has recently published a pamphlet on how to conduct one of these forums. The idea is to provide very much the kind of information that this notebook we got today provides, and also to bring people together to try to understand the range of viewpoints so that as we move towards decisions about what to do, everybody may not always agree with the approach, but they understand why people are coming there. So often we're dismissive of people whose approaches we don't understand. If they just stop talking about that and do it the way I say, we'd have this problem solved. And so the whole concept behind what we're trying to do is find a way to have these conversations so that people come away from them. Maybe they still have the same point of view, but they have a much better appreciation for what others are thinking. So I would invite you all, those of you that might be interested, to have us try this out in the Monadnock region. And I'm not trying to be a social experimenter here. It's something that we're looking to try to bring to the community And this may be one of the things that we do.
Thanks, Jim. Lee?
So to wet your whistle on what's coming down the pike, there's a project through the Dartmouth Health, Dartmouth-Hitchcock system called Rethink Health. And for those of you who are on the advisory board for Healthy Monadnock, you know a little bit more. So if I screw any of this up, do correct me or fill in the gaps that I'm missing. So the Ripple Foundation is funding this project for a community to look at how it engages diverse stakeholder groups and looks at community health improvement needs and activities and comes out the other end with a clear process and plan for how they're going to address the needs in their community. And part of what they have is an electronic model for figuring this stuff out. So when I think about some of the things we've talked about today, 6% of the identified individuals needing treatment are able to access it, meaning 94% aren't. What would it mean to our community if we invested $10 million focused on treatment access to that 94% of our population that needs treatment? How does that move the needle from a community perspective of health and wellness? Transportation is always a problem. You look at our community health needs assessments, HCS's community health needs assessment, Monadnock Community Hospital needs assessment over time. Transportation is always a problem. It's always a priority. What would it mean for our community if we took $10 million and invested in transportation? How does that change the needle? How does that change the needle for health and wellness in our community?
Huge.
Primary care access is a huge problem. It is really difficult to get primary care docs. What does it do to our community if we bring in 20 more primary care docs between our hospitals? How does that change health and wellness in our community?
Finding those doctors.
Yeah, that's another thing. How do we know that? We don't right now. We can sort of surmise. So part of what Rethink Health is about is creating a simulation model using a web-based portal, plug in all this data, hit a button, and it will give you, based on the data in your community and what you're looking to potentially do, how it may impact the health of our community. So as the Council for Healthier Communities, part of our task to the future is really, as you know, as Sarah said, is we're developing our community health improvement plan based on our priorities, based on what the data says our priorities are in our community. And we brought it here. We've been doing this in September. The executive committee has been rolling up their sleeves and looking at, based on the state plan, what are our priorities. And we know emergency preparedness, misuse of alcohol and other drugs, behavioral health, tobacco, obesity, those are the things that are rising up as the really important priorities. But what, you know, so part of what we are using is our data, is based on the data determining what our priorities are, what our needs are, and then who's doing what in our community. How cool will it be to have a model like this that can help us, it's one more tool in our toolkit, to help us look at, from a community wellness perspective, what can we do to prioritize, and then where do we put those dollars? Again, we are heading in the direction someday the state is going to block grant all of those dollars through the DHHS and through the Division of Public Health and say to us, you got $30 million, what are you going to do with it? So having this resource gives us one more look at how we might, in a real educated way, make those decisions around funding opportunities. So part of the process, and they've been working with Healthy Monadnock in terms of the work that we have been doing in our community around setting priorities, setting action items, you know, how are we looking, how are we going to become the healthiest, not the wealthiest, that would be good too, the healthiest community by the year 2020. We got 5 years left to get there. So we're really, you know, we're bumping it up a notch. And so part of what this Rethink Health is doing is looking at this model and how we can begin to use it. So to the future, in May, one of our council meeting might be focused on bringing Rethink in to help us, in connection with the Healthy Monadnock Advisory Board, look at what is our vision, what's our mission, where are we going, are we all on the same page? My friend Gordon keeps, you know, his hammer has been, we got all these assets. Well, we still have problems. So we're not doing something right. And so part of this process really is beginning to try and look at how can we utilize those assets most effectively and not be siloed, not having doctors prescribe 150 oxycodone to somebody while over here we're trying to provide treatment to that same person. How can we all get on the same page and be heading in the right direction? So May is likely to be a conversation. Potentially before that, we may be sending out a survey to you to ask you some questions. 10 or 15 minutes, really, it's a really quick survey. June, perhaps a meeting to model, to demonstrate this stimulation model, to see, you know, Trisha's been working with them, giving them all sorts of data sets for our community, for our state. They are working to develop the model to our community, so we need to look at it and say, okay, you did all this work. Does it really accurately reflect what we know our community to be? So really great opportunity. I sort of feel like, you know, we have all this alignment happening that's eventually bringing us on the same page. So hopefully in a couple of years, Gordon won't be still asking, how come we're not all heading in the same direction at the same time? So stay tuned, more information to come. It's really exciting. Mm-hmm.